ever feel like you have something to say, bottled up inside. Even when you're almost there, but you feel too scared to veer from black and white. Don't be afraid, your potential has no limits. Take a leap of faith and jump right in to full color now. Take your dreams and bring them out. Unleash your power. Let's do this together. Full color now. Time to push away the doubt. When you feel you've finally found the truth, the world is waiting for you. And if you're feeling stuck in patterns you can't change, to bloom you need a little rain. Whoa, I wanna see you shine, so come on, share your light. We'll lift each other up. Don't be afraid, your potential has no limits. Take a leap of faith and jump right in. Your dreams and bring them out. Unleash your power. Let's do this together. Full color now. Time to push away the doubt. When you feel you finally found the truth, the world is waiting for you. Potential has no limits. Take a leap of faith and jump right in.
The dust ever break free. You see them reaching for the stars, but you're too slow. Little do you see it, little do you know. Wishing you can fly, but it's clear you're stuck in a place. And never gonna make it to the front, just can't keep pace. You hear them calling your name, but you can't go. Little do you see it, little do you know. This is your time, so go and grab the moment. Face the world and show it. Oh, oh, oh. This is your time to show the world the glory. Celebrate your story. This is your time.
This is your time.
This is your time.
This is your time.
your time.
Hey, I hope you enjoyed the video. In order to download my full album, click down below and you'll see all the links available. And don't forget.
Cold inside, the sky is bleak. There's been no sun, you're feeling weak. You try to source your inner strength. Winter's cold, but we build with snow. Fall shows us beauty and letting go. And summer's warmth is captivating. Keep changing, and so do me and you. We all have the winters we have to go through. A change of season or a season of change. With your perspective, have the words rearranged. We're strong when we hold each other's hands, facing the struggles in the master plan. He smiles when he sees us all unite. When we help each other fight, it's the season of change. We're stronger together, no matter the weather. It always gets better.
Season of change.
Let's strengthen each other. We're sisters and brothers through sunshine and thunder.
Season of change.
No winter lasts, no spring skips its turn. Autumn comes to soothe the summer's burn. Force of nature proves that things will change. You'll never live a life full of pain. The ups and downs is what it's all about. And when you're feeling good, it's time for branching out. We'd grow faster in our time of need if we nurture each other's seeds. Other fight, it's the season of change. We're stronger together, no matter the weather. It always gets better.
Season of change.
Let's strengthen each other. We're sisters and brothers through sunshine and thunder.
Season of change.
We're strong when we hold each other's hands, facing the struggles in the master plan. He smiles when he sees us all unite. When we help each other fight, it's the season of change. We're stronger together, no matter the weather. It always gets better.
Season of change.
Let's strengthen each other. We're sisters and brothers through sunshine and thunder.
The season of change.
Ever feel like you have something to say, bottled up inside? Even when you're almost there, but you feel too scared to veer from black and white. Don't be afraid, your potential has no limits. Take a leap of faith and jump right in to full color. Your dreams and bring them out. Unleash
even if you're feeling stuck in patterns you can't change, to bloom you need a little rain. Whoa, I want to see you shine, so come on, share your light, we'll lift each other up. Don't be afraid, your potential has no limits. Take a leap of faith and jump right in.
Welcome, everybody. This is incredible. I see the chat box being flooded with different cities from all around, not just the country, from all around the world. Someone popped up on my screen that said, Netanya. Who is still up in Netanya? We have Denver, Colorado. We have from New York, from, oh, Muncie, from Miami. Hi, I might be down the block from you. This is great. Clifton, New Jersey. This is a really, really, really remarkable experience. We have a lot more people pouring in. Tonight we're expecting over 1,000 people doing challah together. We have large groups, which I'm going to point out to you soon, but I first want to welcome you to the Great Big Influencers Challah Bake. It is such an incredible honor to be able to share a stage with some of these remarkable people. I want to call attention to the partners in Torah staff. If you see people on your screen that have partners in Torah next to them, you know that we have a huge staff that helped us be able to bring you ladies together in the same room tonight from everywhere around the globe. They worked around the clock to be able to share this magic with you. So thank you so much. And before we get started, put in the chat box how you're feeling tonight. I saw a bunch of people saying that they're excited and that they're pumped and they're ready to go and their hands are ready to get sticky. Little children, mommies, make sure that your hands are washed and clean. I wanna thank you so much for joining me tonight. Now, first of all, before we get started, I'm going to do something brave. I'm going to ask all of you to unmute yourselves for 1 second, maybe. That was amazing. That was incredible. Thank you. I wanted to get everybody pumped up to be ready to share and laugh and cry and be inspired tonight. I wanted to hear your voices because it's so sad that we can't be all in the same room, somewhere in Yerushalayim, making challah together in the streets. That would have been amazing to see Toronto, Ontario coming in. So let's get started. First and foremost, there's a few amazing women who brought large groups. Some of them are doing big screens projected on their walls, and they have some outdoor events where they have 40, 50, 60. We have one woman who has 80 people who are joining her tonight. So I wanted to give big shout outs to some of the ladies who brought big groups of women. You are what we call the leaders behind the scenes. The leaders behind the scenes, you're waiting. You bring other people to get inspired. And then you stand back and you get nachas for all of the people that you brought to the table. So I want to thank you to Jody Perkel, who has a huge group from NCSY. If you're from NCSY, I can see you. Wave your hands and show me who you are. H Campus in Toronto, Mandy Greenspan and Mati Blackman. I know you have a really big group up in Canada. Give me a wave, shout out, show me in the chat box. I see a woohoo NCSY. Spark from Orlando, Sarah Gittleson. I saw you said hi in the chat before. Wave if you're from Spark. Natalie Honig brought a nice group from Shalhevet High School in Los Angeles. So I'm assuming you guys either just finished school or maybe they sent you, I have no idea, but I was told you brought a big, gigantic group. Rage from New York, Rage from Maryland, was brought by Rebecca Salmon and Tamar Livingston. She's my friend. Hi, Tamar. Ah, she says, yay, Rage in the chat box. We also have Torch in Houston, Zahava Wolby. Thank you so much for bringing people tonight. Orlando Torah Center, Shoshi Kramer is a close friend of mine. I grew up with her and she's bringing people. And we have Esther Monica Katz as a big group from Rutgers University. Thank you for joining us.
Nadler,
please make sure you're muted. Hila Nadler and Yehuda Solomon from Maor, Boston University. I see we have woohoo Rutgers in the chat. This chat box is so much fun. And then we have Momentum Ladies who are joining us from all over the country. And then last but definitely not least, something that's really close to my heart, Liat Gorelick, who's a good friend of mine, is bringing a huge group of women from the Seriously Sold, the Olam Me Seriously Sold group. Thank you for being the women who don't just care about their own lives and their children's lives, for taking time, for sending texts, for sending emails, and bringing people to the doorstep of inspiration. In the same way that you shared your time with others, Hashem should share eagerly with you. So thank you for joining. Okay, few words. If you aren't aware, this challah bake does not exist in a vacuum. This challah bake is really the beginning of a magical weekend where people from all over the world, and when I say all over the world, I mean not just one person from Netanya, another person from California. I mean people from all over the world, quite literally from South Africa to Italy to Mexico, are all being involved in something called the Shabbat Project. And the Shabbat Project is really about bringing Shabbos alive for the Jewish nation, because it's our bond with Hashem. It's our bond with God. So this is really in honor of this amazing Shabbos Project. We have partnered actually with the Shabbos Project that we're not just keeping it together for one weekend. We're keeping it together for a Shabbos learning program because we recognize that it's really challenging to be able to feel like you're together when we're really very much apart and very much separated. So for the next 3 weeks, we have launched in partnership with the Shabbat Project, a magnificent inspirational learning program where you can learn with a partner, because that's what Partners in Torah is all about. We'll get to that soon. Learn with a partner for a half hour a week for the next 3 weeks so that the inspiration that we feel in the Shabbat Project or the inspiration that we feel tonight can carry forward, not just for 3 weeks, but hopefully forever. I want to thank my daughters for joining in. This is Esti Stillerman. This is Ita Stillerman, who are my beautiful ladies in waiting. And without further ado, I'd like to get started with introducing our influencers. First and foremost, get Barry on the screen. Barry, I want to thank you for joining us. You're a remarkable human being. Let me see a wave from Barry. Is she there? I know this is so hard when everything is dependent on technology. Hopefully we'll be able to see her soon. Barry, are you there? Okay, we'll see her soon. Then we're gonna introduce, is Elizabeth there? Elizabeth, are you there? Welcome, Barry. Okay, so hopefully we'll be able to get them on soon. But we have Elizabeth, we have Barry, we have Beatty, we have Danielle. Danielle Renna from Eretz Yisrael, famous for all of her cooking skills and her inspiration. We have Nikki, we have Nina, and we have Charlene. I'm so incredibly honored to be able to share the platform with you. Without further ado, oh my goodness, Deborah just said that she's watching. Ah, Debbie Berger, who's my neighbor, said she's watching from the airplane up in the sky. If that's not remarkable, I don't know what is. So without a further ado, I would like to introduce Danielle. Danielle Renov is a remarkable human being. I actually didn't know who she was until about a few weeks ago, because I'm not that active on social media. And when I mentioned that I wanted to get Danielle Renov to be able to do this challah bake, everybody that was in the room said, oh my goodness, if you get Danielle, then that's everything. They were inspired by her. She just recently put out a cookbook called Peas, Love, and Carrots, which is the same name of her Instagram. And she's definitely a worthwhile person to follow every single day. You meet her children, like you see right now, who are so lucky to be up this late. She lives in Eretz Yisrael. Someone just said it's the best cookbook out there, and I have a feeling that there are thousands of people who share a similar sentiment. So without further ado, someone like me, who's really a challah baking, you know, I'm a baking dummy, first of all. That's my term that I call myself. A challah is the one thing that I make. I can't wait to be able to learn with Danielle today. So without further ado, let's get started with putting our ingredients together with Danielle Renov. And if, instead of doing the clapping, you guys can put up your hands so we can see that you guys are super, super, super excited. Hands up, fantastic. And by the way, I just wanted to share with you that we're going to be giving out prizes at the evening. And if your video is not on, you can't win a prize. So put your videos on and let's get started. Danielle, take it away.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, okay, amazing. Hi, everybody. Hello, hello. Thank you so much for being here tonight. We are really honored to be here, right? These girls were sleeping. I actually went in to wake Leia Bela up, who's almost 10 years old, and then Maggie woke up, so she decided to join us. It happens to be these are my two most kitchen-loving children anyway, so it worked out really well. And we love to make challah together, so it's really perfect. Baruch Hashem. I'm really, really honored to be here. You know, I've done a lot of challah bakes over the last few years, and I can honestly say this is the first time I've ever come together with women from all over the world at one challah bake. And when I was jumping in the shower to get ready for this, it occurred to me at first second, I was like, you know, it's so sad that we're so many women from all over the world and we can't be together. And then I like literally had a flash and I was like, wait a second, no, it's so amazing that we're so many women from all over the world and we're coming together for this challah bake, because had the circumstances of the last year not occurred, and hope, you know, for whatever reason they had to occur, I don't know, but if that hadn't happened and Zoom hadn't become, and technology hadn't become such a major part of how we interact with one another, we never, ever, ever would have come together like this. And it's just unbelievable and beautiful and amazing that it's the middle of the night here. It's earlier in the day in California. It's evening time on the East Coast. It's, I don't know what time, I'm not good at math, on the other side of the world. But it's amazing that we could all be here together. And I really think this is a once in a lifetime opportunity. And my hope is that everybody's tefillos tonight, when we're sitting here making the challahs, bounce off one another and just keep multiplying and multiplying and really, really reach Shamayim and help bring down Mashiach, which is the ultimate goal always for all of us, that we should all be zocha and privileged to see Mashiach with our own eyes very, very quickly. Amen. Okay, so I want to jump right into making challah. I personally love, love, love to make challah. It's very therapeutic. I will tell you, for like the first 11 years I was married, I did it in a bowl by hand. You do not need to be a hero. If you are new to making challah, maybe you'll start, you won't want to invest in like a Bosch mixer or something like that to actually make the dough. But once you get used to it and it's something you really want to take on every week, there's no shame in buying a mixer. It took me 11 years to learn that. And this recipe actually works really well by hand or in the mixer. You can do either one with it. So we're just going to jump right in. It's kind of like a no-fail recipe. You can use white flour, you can use spelt, you can use white spelt, you can use whole wheat. It will be a little bit denser, but it will be fine. My favorites are really white flour or white spelt. If you use white spelt, bonus, the rising time will take much faster because the spelt rises faster. Okay, are you ready?
Yeah.
So when you're making challah, the thing is that challah is really a process. It's actually not as much about the taste. And the act of making challah is very, very spiritual, because challah is really bread, it's food, it's a physical form of nourishment, but it's the one food we have where we merge and fuse together the physical nourishment and our spiritual and emotional nourishment. And it's a really unbelievable different category of food, because it's through the action of making it, through the action of putting our prayers, our hopes, our wishes, our tears, everything we feel we put into that challah, That is what takes this very materialistic thing and turns it to this beautiful spiritual vessel that we get to bring into our homes all the time. And, you know, I think it's not even just through the act of making the challah and spending the time davening, but it's also through the act of creating something that's laborious and takes time, but that we do for our family and we do for Hashem. And it just gives over the most powerful message to the people we love that this is what we do for them. We're davening for them. We're praying for them. We're hoping for them. You know, we're not just feeding them because we're here to try and keep them alive or give them what we need. We're doing extra. We don't just want to feed their bodies. We want to feed every part of them, their emotional well-being, their spiritual well-being. And I personally love that about challah. So whenever I put an ingredient into my bowl, I always like to think of something specific tied to the ingredient that I like to pray for. So the first thing we have is yeast. Yeast is actually a really, really easy one. We're going to take 3 tablespoons and we're just going to pour them in. If you're using packets, it's 4 packets, by the way, in America, because each packet is 2 1/4 teaspoons back. Last one. When I put in the yeast, I always like to think in my mind, yeast is actually this very materialistic item. You know, people that in the olden days that couldn't afford yeast, couldn't afford yeast. They made sourdough. Ironically, sourdough is more expensive today. But yeast is really the more expensive ingredient in our doughs. And yeast represents growth. It kind of inflates everything. So when I put the yeast in the bowl, I always put it in first. And I think, Hashem, I'm in this world. This is where I'm at. I'm in this very materialistic world. Help me to grow beyond it. Help me to move past it. Help me not to get sucked in. Help me to see past all the materialism, but not just see past it. Help me to take the materialism and elevate it, which is what challah is all about. And that's why I always put it in first, because I want it in the bowl. I want the materialism in there, and then I'm going to add all the spirituality in, and I'm not going to leave it alone, because yeast alone is gross. It doesn't taste good. It doesn't smell very good, but we're going to elevate that. So now we're going to go in with sugar. And sugar is an easy one. Sugar, honey, whatever you're using, sugar represents sweetness. And I daven for sugar in a few different aspects. We're gonna go in with 3/4 cup. I'm not so exact, I use a 1/2 cup and then I just fill it up halfway. I daven to Hashem that anything he sends my way should be received by me with sweetness. And that's a really hard one, because we go through life and there are so many difficulties. Every single day we face challenges. We face challenges. Some of us deal with real sorrows, with real troubles and real traumas. And it's really difficult. And it's really difficult to connect to Hashem at those times. And I always dive into Hashem when I put in the sugar, please Hashem, please let me deal with whatever you put my way, the good and the hard. It's all good. We don't see why, but it's all good. I know that. I'm not going to use the word bad, but some of it is hard. Help me take it in and see the sweetness in it. Help me perceive it in a sweet way. And then of course, also, you know, just give me the sweet stuff. No more hard stuff. Just sweet stuff, Hashem. Please, please, please. And now we're going in with water. And water is really a life source, right? You wanna go? Yeah. Go. Sorry, it's heavy. 1 second. We're adding in our water. I don't even mix it. I just like give it a little smushy smush like that. Just shake, shake. And now we're gonna let it sit for a few minutes and we're gonna let all those things activate. Your water, by the way, not too hot, not too cold, not room temperature either. In between room temperature and too hot. We don't want to burn the yeast, but we want the heat to activate the yeast. I would say like baby bath temperature, but you might want to use your elbow to feel, because like if you cook a lot, maybe your fingers don't have such good feeling anymore. And then you're constantly burning, you know, things because you're touching it and it's too hot. Water is really a life source. And just like water is a life source, so is Torah. And what the Kabbalists bring down is that when we pour in the water, we should think about how the same way we rely on water to sustain us, that we should be sustained by Torah and by mitzvos, and we should dive into Hashem to always be reliant on the Torah. Now, I personally, this is my own thing, like to take it one step further. You know, I think water is like this really remarkable thing because it doesn't ever go away, right? The rain comes down, it fills our oceans, it fills our rivers, it goes in the grass, and then it goes back up and it just gets recycled. It's like endless. It never actually disappears, right? It never goes away. Like, the world was given this amount of water, and it's just a matter of Hashem letting it down, bringing it down here, bringing it down there, bringing it down there. And it's constantly recycling and it's constantly flowing somewhere. Somewhere there's water flowing, there's gases happening, there's water happening somewhere. And I always think about my children when I'm making challah. And I think the same way that water is constant and existing, I want Torah to be constant and existing, not just from me to them, but please God, from them to their children and those children to their children. And the same way it was passed down to me from my mother and my grandmother, I want the Torah to be everlasting. And I daven to Hashem to please Hashem, let the Torah be everlasting. Let my children have arichas yamim. Let them have long days and healthy lives so that they can pass down the Torah one day, please God, to their own healthy children. And I love that about water. Okay, once you see some bubbles and your yeast is good to go, we can move right along. Next thing, what's the next thing we put in?
Flour.
Ding, ding, ding. In America, your flour is gonna come in 5-pound bags. In Israel, our flour is going to come in 1 kilo bags, which is 2.2 pounds. So you're going to use two bags plus extra flour, which is why we have this right here, which is just like a, hold on, I'm moving you over. We have so many cameras going on here. I don't know where to look. We have a container of flour. So I always put in two bags and then I put in like 3 to 4 cups extra, maybe 2 cups. That depends on the weather. If you have 5-pound bag, don't worry. You're just going to pour half in now. We're gonna right away go ahead and we're gonna get in our flour. I like to put in 1 bag and 2 cups of flour right away. And then just from a technical baking standpoint, I like to start mixing that. I don't like to add in the other bag of flour. I want this to absorb the water and the yeast, and I want to start activating those gluten strands. It's kind of a head start on the challah process. I'm going to pass this over to Laila Bela. She is going to do our mixing. There we go. Can you mix this, Lush? Yeah, and now me and Maggie are going to measure the rest of the ingredients. Ready? Okay, hold on, babe. Uh-oh. Did we just drop a bag of flour?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, she's going to get it. It was an empty bag of flour. It's okay. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to pour in my 1 cup of oil. When I pour in the oil, you're supposed to think about the fact that oil was used in the times of the temple, of the Beis HaMikdash, to anoint our kings. And we are supposed to be anointing ourselves as the children of kings. And anointing ourselves as the children of kings and praying for, you know, some sort of kingly feature that we want to add to our lives or to our children's lives and somebody specific. But I also like to take that a little bit in a different direction. I think that if we're thinking about ourselves as the children of kings, it's because Hashem is our king. And if we are his children, then he is our father. And if we're anointing him as our king and our father, then we're also entitled to the privileges that children receive from their father, which is the unending, unfiltered, unconditional, merciful love that fathers show, please God, hopefully shower down onto their children. And I daven that Hashem should always treat us that way, and we should always view Hashem as the merciful and the loving Father that He is to us. So now, next up, we have eggs. Yeah, keep not yet. It's a hard job mixing the dough. It's really a workout. Okay, we're gonna go in with our eggs. Give it a check. We're good to go. Is it good? Okay, excellent. Oh, I see. Very good. Let's add that in. Next egg.
You could basically not even see a little bit of
red. Yeah. Okay, let's see. How do we look? Very good. Very good. Okay, now we're adding in our eggs, and eggs is an easy one. Eggs symbolizes vitality, and you want to mix? Okay, no problem. eggs represent rebirth and continuation, and eggs is a really ideal time to daven for children, to daven for somebody you know that's suffering through infertility, to daven for yourself, for future children, and that's what I like to think about when I add in the eggs. And next up, we have the rest of the sugar. Just another time to daven for sweetness. That's kind of why I like splitting up the sugar, so that I can daven for sweetness twice, because I feel like there's no ending to the amount of sweetness that I want my eyes to take in and that I want to be able to accept from Hashem. Here, Max. So I add in the sugar now. If you're adding in honey, you can absolutely add that in now. Let's go. 1, 2, 3. Excellent. A little more. Where were you going?
I was just kidding.
Okay, go.
That's good.
That is amazing. Okay, very good. And the last thing we're going to add is not traditional. Traditionally, challah has 7 ingredients: flour, water, yeast, sugar, salt,
eggs,
oil. Thank you. 7 ingredients. I add an 8th ingredient just because it's delicious. I add in vanilla extract. It's yum. You could use vanilla sugar if you want. It kind of gives this like sweet, salty. That's just for the deliciousness. You don't have to use it. And now we're going to mix it all up. You ready, Max? Okay, there you go. While Maggie's doing that, I'm going to go ahead and add my salt. I really need to thank Naomi Elberg, Naomi TJS on Instagram. She is a baking master, and she taught me all about the trick of using pink salt in your challah dough, because it makes it rise faster, because the Himalayan salt reacts with the yeast just in a better way, and it just makes it rise faster. Also, you kind of get these little pink flecks in the dough. They disappear when you bake them, but it's just very pretty while you're kneading it, and I enjoy that. So we're going to go in with 2 tablespoons of salt. And the reason we add that after we add in the first bag of flour is because salt really deactivates yeast. So we want to give the flour a second to absorb all of the yeast. And then we go ahead and put in our salts. Now, if you don't have pink salt, you can go ahead and use coarse sea salt or kosher salt. The only thing is, if you're using table salt and it's more finely ground, maybe you're going to want to use a tablespoon plus a teaspoon, or a tablespoon plus 2 teaspoons, because the measurement, it will be saltier. It will be saltier to use table salt than it will be to use a coarser grain salt. Okay, my turn. Oh, you know what happened? We didn't add in this mixture. That's why it's so hard to mix. Okay, that's fine. Usually I put in this mixture before we put in the flour to the yeast and sugar mixture. That's okay. We're just going to get this all mixed up now. We didn't get too far along in the process, so we're all good. Should I mix for a second?
Yeah.
Okay, we're just gonna go ahead and mixing. And the kneading is really the time where our tefillos come, where we have the opportunity to pray for whatever we want. Right now we're unifying all of the ingredients, so it's an opportune time to pray for the unity of the Jewish people, to pray for the unity of the world, to pray that we should all be accepting of each other and loving of each other, and we should all come together as one. And please, God, we should all rejoice together quickly in the 3rd and final Beis HaMikdash. Now, if you were using honey, I'm just reading the, I'm like, the comments are popping up on my phone. If you were using honey, you would have just put the honey in right away with your oil and egg mixture. And that's when you would have added it in. I only use honey Rosh Hashanah time, because they say not to give honey to kids under 1. I don't have anybody under 1, but it's like, in case somebody comes to my house. I mean, nobody's coming to my house. We're in quarantine right now because we came back from America. That's why everybody's up. We have no, time doesn't mean anything to us anymore. It's day 11. Okay, there we go. Oh my gosh. See, it's very, very sticky. Very sticky. Which is exactly what we want. And you could see, as you turn the bowl, It was one cup of oil, Nikki. I'm just reading the comments that we are literally stretching the gluten strands. That's what we want. And that is what is going to produce a really fluffy dough. Okay, Labela, mix it up. I'm going to go ahead and start adding our extra cups of flour. Yeah, we're not ready for hands yet. We're going to wait till it's a little bit less sticky to go in with our hands. One. And two. If you're using a 5-pound bag of flour, I would take out 1 to 2 cups and then just pour the rest in. Based on the humidity, based on the humidity in your kitchen, you may or may not need all of it. There you go. Excellent work. Put that in here because we don't need that one anymore. Good job. You want to add in the bag?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's just make room here to keep it clean. What's the first rule? Keep everything clean. She knows. It was all worth it for that. What? Yep. That's perfect. And now we're just going to start mixing. This is when the kneading begins. This is when I like to, I like to turn on. Oh, because we're going to mix it into dough. We're going to keep pulling in and kneading it.
I'm mixing it once.
Yes. This is really when I like to daven. I like to put on music and I like to really, really think about what's going on in my family. I like to think about one specific thing for every member that for that week or that year, something we're working on, something for myself, and to really just take the time to daven for the Jewish people, which most of the time I'm just consumed with my own family and the tefillos that I need for us to get through the day, month, week, year. And when I make challah, I really, because it's something that traditionally in the times of the temple we brought to the Kohen, I really like to take up 2 minutes of my kneading and focus on Klal Yisrael and the nation, the Jewish nation as a whole, and think about what we need. And right now, all I daven for is unity and love and acceptance. And please God, all of our tefillah should be answered with Tova. I'm going to stay here and continue kneading. We're going to want to knead this. Listen, I would say for a full 10 minutes, but if you need it for 15 minutes, bonus, bonus, bonus. Once you finish kneading, you're going to take a little extra oil in the palm of your hand. You're going to grease the dough, like just rub it all over, and we're going to put saran wrap directly on the dough. I know you're like, that's crazy. It's not crazy. We're going to choke the dough. That's what it's called. It's a technical term. It's such a weird word term. We're going to choke the dough by putting the saran wrap directly on it, which is sort of depriving it of oxygen. And that's actually going to help the dough rise really nice and puffy. And the saran wrap and the oil are going to protect the dough from drying out. And then you're going to let it rise. It will take like about 1.5 to 2 hours. You're going to punch it down.
I'm done.
You're done?
Yes.
You're going to punch it down and you're going to let it rise again. Now, the thing is, if you don't want to make your challah tonight because it's already late and you're just tired, you're going to take your dough, you're going to put on the oil, all that, and you're going to stick it right in the fridge. I know, it's crazy. And then you're just going to walk away. Walk away. Put it in the fridge. Come back to it tomorrow morning. 3 hours before you want to make your challah, you're going to take it out of the fridge, punch it down, let it come to room temperature, rise back up, and then you're going to go ahead and break your challah, and it's going to be really, really simple and easy. And that's it. And then I'll see you guys back here in a little bit to braid the challah.
Thank you so much, Danielle. That was really, really, I learned something new. It's called choking the challah, the dough. And I have to say that as you're kneading that dough, what I like to think of is you're putting all that, you know, pressure and that energy into it and putting all of that stress into it. Always, always, always let your energy and your stress out on the dough and not your loved ones. And each time I push it, I think, Hashem, I'm so frustrated with some of the things in my life, but I'm going to push it into this dough, bake it in the oven. And I know when it comes out, it's going to be nourishing for my entire family. But maybe that's just because I have sometimes this stress builds up. I want to introduce the next person who actually is a very dear friend of mine. I met Beatty. Before she was famous, Beatty, I met her at a conference. And she by far, I hope she forgives me for saying this, she by far was the smallest woman in the entire room. A tiny little woman who was heavily pregnant, running around without her shoes because she had feet problems, running around the whole room, running the entire conference. Beatty, do you remember this?
We met. Yes, I do.
And I said, who on earth is that woman? And she was one of the presenters at the conference. And she stood in front of that podium with hundreds of people in the room, and she opened up her mouth, and I was like, wow, this is a small woman with a very big mouth who has a lot to share. And she's been an inspiration for me for so long. But I'll tell you a little bit about Beatty's accomplishments. I'm reading from my phone because for me, her accomplishments are just who she is in character. Beatty Deitch is the Israeli national champion in the marathon and half marathon as a mother of five young children. She has learned to apply her training to the real marathon of life. She took up running just 5 years ago and recently went pro with the goal of representing Israel in the Tokyo 2021 Olympics. Beatty is active on social media. She's a powerful speaker and she's inspired thousands of people with her speeches. She's also an advocate for Beit Daniela. She has also made, she's made it her mission to help children struggling with mental health. She raises awareness for this important cause, and she's grateful for the opportunity to make a difference through her running. Beatty proudly represents Israel on an international stage, and she was named one of the 50 most influential Jews of 2019 by J-Post. Thank you, Beatty, for coming and joining us. What do you have to share with us? What are you thinking about as you're kneading the dough?
First of all, I am just like so blown away by this whole event. I honestly am always really skeptical about Zoom get-togethers. Like I like being in person. I didn't tell Adina this, but like, it's like, why? I could just bake challah at my house. Why should I do on Zoom with 1,000 other people? But literally being here, I am so energized right now. First of all, Danielle just took it away. I've done challah bakes so many times. I've been doing it since I lived in Tucson for 2 years. I did it with hundreds of Israel trips. I never heard everything explained so beautifully and inspiring like Danielle. You literally moved me. Thank you so much. And I'm really so humbled to be in my kitchen, sharing this experience with you. So I just want to share, you know, the truth is that if you had told me 5 years ago, I would be standing here tonight at 1:45 in the morning saying, hi, I'm Israel's national marathon champion and I'm a candidate for the Tokyo 2021 Olympics, I would have laughed in your face because 5 years ago, I wasn't running at all. The most running I was doing was like after my kids are on the couch. I barely knew what a marathon was. I didn't know what the Olympics were. It wasn't even on my mind. And it's literally 5 years to this month that I took up running. And I never would have imagined this is where it would take me. But what I've learned the most on my journey, more than anything else, is that we have so much more strength within us than we realize. We are so much more capable than we even know. And that with our emuna and our trust and faith in Hashem, we can achieve anything. So the news article headlines like to call me the ultra-Orthodox mother running on faith. And people often ask me, like, how do you have such emuna? What's your secret? Because I talk very openly. I've had some really crazy stories where the odds were against me, where it was like, and like through it all, I was able to continue to really trust Hashem was going to bring me through it. And he did. And people ask me like, how do you continue to have that faith? And here's my little secret. Emuna is a muscle. There's that muscle that we flex over and over and over again, and that we need to develop and build. It's just like any other muscle in our body. How do we work our muscles? How do they get stronger? Only by applying repeated force and pushing them through situations that challenge, by increasing the resistance, by going through that motion day in, day out. That is how our muscles become stronger. That's how they become defined. You know, say you want to become stronger at push-ups. You start out, you could barely do three. But if you continue to repeat that motion over and over and over again, soon you'll be 5, and then 10, and then 20. Those muscles will develop because you put them through that exact training over and again consistently. And they're learning to adapt to the force. It's the same thing with emuna. What do I mean by this? So if I would describe myself several years ago, I was not the type of person who could handle frustrations and disappointments very easily. It was really hard for me to accept when things didn't work out. And I think that all of us, when things are going our way, it's so easy to see Yad Hashem, the hand of God in our life. Of course, like, yes, when we find that perfect parking spot, we're always like, oh my gosh, thank God, like he was right there for me. When we miraculously pass the test or land a job, we like can clearly say, God's taking care of me. But then all of a sudden, when things get hard, that's when we begin to sometimes struggle with our faith. And we question, like, why is God bringing this on me right now? And it's so much harder in those difficult moments to feel God's loving embrace by our side. So how do we change that? Here's the thing. It's going to take building up that emunah muscle. And initially, it might feel very forced. But what I've learned to tell myself is to say, you know, Hashem has a plan for me. God has a plan for me. He is running the world. And whatever he's sending me right now is exactly what I need in my life to become the best version of myself. God knows what I need. He knows me best. And if he's sending this challenge my way, it's because that's what I need to become the best version of me in this world. And I couldn't do it without that challenge. In the beginning, we might not even believe it. We might not really, like, it might not make sense to us. But if you learn to say that every time you go through and face an obstacle, every time you're faced with adversity, slowly, slowly, those words sink in. It becomes automatic. It's a message you internalize to the point that soon, not only are you saying it, when you face that challenge, you can already be asking yourself, like, how am I going to come out stronger from this? How is this going to, what am I going to learn about myself that I didn't know before? Because every challenge now I've learned running has really helped me see, because it pushes me to my limit, because it requires me to step out of my comfort zone. Every challenge is actually a gift. It's that opportunity. And I'm able to embrace the challenges in my life as a result. You know, right now, I'm training to try and represent Israel in the Olympics, and I've been faced with a number of big challenges. One is that they moved the date of the marathon to Shabbat, so I don't even know if I'll be able to run in that marathon. The second thing is that I need to requalify because they moved the Olympics, the date of the Olympics, to 2021. But with Corona, every race has been canceled. So this entire year, I've been training for a marathon to try and run a marathon in 2 hours and 29 minutes. And there's been no races. I've been healthy. My training's been great. Finally, December, I found a race in Arizona. And they were only taking the top 50 women in America. And they said, they'll make an exception for me. Even though I'm from Israel, they'll take me all the way from Israel. And I was so excited. I finally have a race to try and run the standard to qualify for Israel. Guess what? 2 weeks ago, I found out I have a stress fracture and I can't run for a month. And it's something that, like, any runner knows, injuries are devastating. And for me, it was like, God, like, why now? Why, when I finally have a race, would you send this to me? But it's crazy. That question didn't even like enter my mind, because I've practiced so many times over and over. That muscle in me, that emunah muscle, is so strong that I can clearly say, you know what? If Hashem doesn't want me to run this race right now, and Hashem has a plan for me, God has a plan for me, and I clearly wasn't meant to run in this race, and he's going to send me the right race and the right time. So right now, I am sitting tight. I'm doing lots of cross training, and I'm trusting and knowing that when the right race comes, Hashem will send it my way. And I truly believe, as women, we are imbued and ingrained with this strong sense of emunah, a faith. And that's how we influence the world. That's how we leave our mark. One of my favorite, I just want to end off with one of my favorite all-time statements from our sages, from Chazal. And I have it hanging on a little like painting that I made in my kitchen. Bezchut nashim tzidkaniot negalu avotinu. It's in our merit that we were redeemed from Egypt. You know what the merit of the woman was? In the darkest, deepest time of despair, they did not give up. So much so that Miriam left Egypt carrying her musical instruments, because she knew with 100% faith that Hashem was going to do a miracle. God was going to perform a miracle. And she wanted to be ready to play those instruments when it happened. And that was the merit that the Jewish people were redeemed from Egypt. And then our sages tell us, in that same merit, bizchutan, in our merit, atidam lihigael, we are going to be redeemed in the future. And it's our emunah, it's our everlasting shining faith that we always know Hashem is with us. We're stronger than we think. Whatever it is, he's by our side, his loving embrace, he's guiding us every step of the way. That is what's going to bring the third Beit HaMikdash and the final redemption for the Jewish people. And I just want to give all of us a blessing that, like Danielle said, we should always feel the sweetness of God in our life. And whatever comes our way, whether it's small or big, difficult things, know that it's really a blessing from Hashem and it's helping us grow into our best versions of ourselves. Thanks for joining us.
Amazing. That was so beautiful. Thank you so much. For all of you who don't know what just happened, and this is one of the things that happens when you're... My children are working very hard on their dough, and then if you... the dough just fell on the floor, and that is a test from Hashem. You can keep kneading it, Kindleff, just to pretend that everything's fine, but it's a test to show that no matter what happens, even when the dough that you worked for so long and kneading it has fallen on the floor, I think it fell in the bowl, so not too bad.
Nothing fell out.
Nothing fell out. Baruch?
Hashem.
Hashem, nothing fell out. So I'm going to introduce my next speaker, Charlene. I had a conversation with her today, and I know why Charlene is sitting at the edge of her seat right now as we speak, because she heard Beatty say the word tambourines. She heard the word, and I know that that makes her excited, because the conversation that I had with her, was it today or yesterday, Charlene? I don't remember. But she was saying that she has tambourines and a packed bag sitting right next to her front door at all times. She wants desperately to remind herself that she is ready and she is waiting to pack her bags, which are, and go off to Eretz Yisrael. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Charlene. My claim to fame is, I think you look a little bit like Charlene, which I've heard quite a few times.
Huge compliment.
I look like Charlene, that's fantastic. But she is one of the busiest women on the planet. She runs a major company, Gali Couture Wigs. She has children, she has a family, she does charities. Who doesn't know Charlene? Charlene Aminov is like, but I do know one thing about her that she's gonna talk about now. The power of Shabbat. We're about to go into Shabbos. This time, tomorrow, is going to be Shabbos. And if we can take this challah and this energy and bring it into Shabbos, Shabbos is like the legacy for the world. I always find it interesting. I'll tell you, Charlene, you might find this fascinating. When human beings were inhabiting the planet and getting to know their environment many, many years ago in ancient times, you can imagine how they built the calendar. Everything is very natural. They looked around at all their surroundings. They saw that the sun rises and the sun sets, hence our 24-hour day. And they saw that there's a cycle with the moon, hence that we have a month. And they saw that there were energies. They saw that there is a system in which the earth is revolving around the sun, and they saw there was a 365-day period, and we had seasons, and therefore we created a year. But where does the week come from? There's nothing that changes in our environments for human beings to ever say, let's create this 7-day week thing. Yet how many human beings across the planet subscribe to the 7-day system? Everybody that we know it since the beginning of recorded history has kept to the 7-day system as if there is an internal calling that we are creations in this world here for a reason, yearning to be able, and I give everybody, it's an amazing thing, what a burst of energy that the Torah has brought to the world when we introduce this concept of Shabbos. 7 days, there's a cycle that we begin again. So Charlene, I wanna ask you something. As a busy woman, you probably always feel like you are holding on by a thin thread at all times.
Thin, tiny.
Thin, thin, tiny, tiny little, tiny hair. You hold on by a hair, not a thread, right? What does Shabbos mean to you, of all people? How are you able to turn it off and just light your candles?
Adina, I can't tell you. First, when I was asked by partners in Torah to be a part of this panel, Koden Kol, first and foremost, when I saw the names, I was like so humbled to be to be even on a flyer with so many unbelievable chashiva, just powerhouses, yourself included, very, very much so. So for me, I think Baruch Hashem, there's 621 people here. I think most women nowadays are busy. Our lives are just so hectic between carpools, and now some kids are Zoom schooling and quarantine and everything. Our lives are almost like just a run-on sentence, and we can't even, I know sometimes I feel like if it weren't for that once a week, delightful, precious gift, the incredible weekly gift Hashem gave me, Shabbat, I would lose my mind completely. And I tell my family, I tell my husband all the time, I say, you can thank Hashem for gifting us with the gift of Shabbat, for the fact that I remain sane and I remain healthy. Because for me, Shabbat is my filling up of my gas. It takes me from E to F right away. It is almost like on a normal night when you go to sleep, you just turn off your computer, but the monitor is still on. So all those tabs are still open. But Shabbat, for me, Shabbat, my computer, the monitor turns off, the computer turns off, the printer turns off, the Wi-Fi turns off, and I disconnect to reconnect. And it is my favorite part of being a Jewish woman, that we are given a gift every single week by Hashem, that He says, put away your away message on all of your inboxes, all of your email accounts. Tell all the factories you can't be reached for 25 hours. Stop work. Stop everything. Focus. We're focusing on you and your family. It's called Yom Menucha, but it's not just Yom Menucha as in the physical day of rest where we finally get sleep. I don't know about you guys, but I do not sleep throughout the week. But Shabbat, I hibernate. I feel like I make up for the lost hours of sleep throughout the week on Shabbat. But it's a Yom Menucha, not just for our physical bodies. It's a Yom Menucha for our mind and for our neshama. It is a mental rest. It is an emotional rest. There's no Fox News alerts. There's no breaking news alerts. No CNN. No poll updates. Nothing. It all just disappears. And Hashem comes front and center, your family comes front and center, and it is the one day a week that I get to just look at my children's faces and say, I forgot what you look like. I see you every morning when you're going to school. I see you when you come home. We have dinner together. Our family is very strict about having dinner together at night. But Shabbat, there's a different flavor. And in fact, for us, for Jewish women, Shabbat has always been so extraordinary, because it's our it's 25 hours where everything shuts off and all our priorities rise. But now what's interesting is that the non-Jewish world has become aware of the amazing ability, the amazing beauty of shutting off for 25 hours. Do you know that there are now rehabs that celebrities can check into? And they immediately take your phone away, and it's a 25-hour digital detox where they take the phones away, they take your devices away, no emails, no iPads, no Zoom, no nothing. And they force you to just downshift. You go from 75 miles per hour, you suddenly downshift to park, and you turn off the car. And if celebrities, lo ali lahavdil, but if celebrities in Hollywood are now discovering the beauty of shutting off for 25 hours, look at how unbelievable HaKadosh Baruch Hu has been all this time, how with so much chachma, He made all of us, that He gave us a weekly gift. We don't have to pay $3,500 a night to check into a hotel that's gonna take our phone away. We get this privilege every week. And for that one day a week, there's nothing. It's just, believe it or not, on Shabbat, I'm in my tichel, no makeup, no, in my Shabbos robe, on my sofa, with my Tehillim, with my Shira Shirim, with my Perek Shira and my Nishmat cards, and stuffing my face with the most delicious challah, the whole 25 hours, it's just, I'm breathing in every second of the Kedusha that Hashem allows us to have. And once you start keeping Shabbat, and once you start appreciating Shabbat, you will not be able to function throughout the week without that. The second we do Havela, I'm already saying, I can't wait for Shabbat. I can't wait for Shabbat because all the inboxes turn on and all the factories start Skyping in. But for us, we have to recognize and say, Hodul Hashem Kito Kilo Olam Chasko. You Hashem, you built us with the ability to shut off completely for 25 hours and to recognize what's most important in life. You, our Torah, our family. So I'm the biggest advocate for keeping Shabbat. And I'm so excited to be able to keep Shabbat together this week with all of Klal Yisrael from all across the world, but especially tonight to be doing this amazing challah project with so many chashava amazing women.
Hello, thank you so much, Charlene. It's really, really eloquent when you said like the whole world is turning and spinning, especially this past week when we had elections. Can I like bare my soul in front of 617 people right now, plus because we have several hundred people that are being shown this, you know, with in our large groups. This is not, I was so glued to my phone this week because of the elections. I'm so embarrassed to say that. And truth be told, I think I'm glued to my phone a lot in general. My kids are right next to me and they could tell you that mommy's so often on her phone. There's one thing that makes me turn off my phone without a shadow of a doubt, and that's when it comes to Shabbos. But I'll tell you something interesting. See my two hands? This is my potential. And this is where I'm at. Do any of you ladies out there ever feel like I could be so much more in my life? I could appreciate Shabbos so much more. I can have so much more patience with my children. I could be so much better at my job. I can have so much more patience with my parents. You, the young ones out there who are get to stay up a little bit, maybe past their bedtime, right? Don't you feel like sometimes you could do better and be better and you want to have, okay. This is that gap, between our potential and who we are right now. How do you close that gap? It's what I like to call the distance between the head and the heart, what you know to be true. But when you're emotionally charged or when you're pulled into different directions because you're distracted, you're being impulsive, how do you close the gap between the head and the heart? The longest distance in the world is the distance between the head and the heart. There's only one way to be able to travel that journey, and that's through learning concepts, learning Torah. So when Partners in Torah reached out to me and said, would you like to join our team? I knew Partners in Torah, who doesn't know what they do? You know who they are? They're investors. They're investors. They want to invest in the Jewish people. This whole entire event right now, we're not asking for money. Many events are fundraisers. What we do is we set up a platform to be able to invest in you as the greatest commodity to the planet, which is the Jewish people to be able to inspire themselves and inspire the world. So one of the reasons why, you see this? You saw some of the influencers. We got gave these out as gifts. And if you stay on to the end of the evening, we're giving out a ton of these to all of you ladies and children and whoever's on the line. We're giving out a bunch of these to you. Alyssa's going to give them to you. Why did I choose a cup? If you see very closely, it says influencers. One of the definitions is every Jewish woman. A cup is such an amazing analogy that how do you impact other people in your life? How do you influence others? How do you become that person that shines a light? How truthfully do you become the person that shines a light on your own personal life, that you feel like you are alive? There's only one way, is if you fill up your cup. Partners in Torah wants to invest in you. So what do they say? They started the Shabbos program, 3 weeks of learning. But unless, I don't wanna tell you any more about it, I'll tell you why. Because we have two very special people who are waiting on the line. Nikki, you're next, just so you can get your, you know, your things rolling. Nikki is actually not joining us for most of this. She's only going to be joining us for 5 minutes because she's working behind the scenes to be able to make sure all social media is going on. Nikki actually works for Partners in Torah behind the scenes, but she is a silent celebrity in her own right. Who is she? She runs something called Humans of Judaism, if you look on Instagram, which has like 170,000 followers or so. She's so incredibly remarkable, and she started the entire movement of being connected to Judaism because she lost her father. But she is one of the busiest people alive, and her partner, who she learns with through Partners in Torah, is none other than celebrity chef Jamie Geller. The two of them learn together every single week. So Nikki, I want you to come to the screen. I want you to share with us what it is like to be able to carve out time out of your busy schedule and spend that moment with another person who you've grown to care about, but you've grown to even love over the years and to be able to invest in yourself. And if, Nikki, you there?
I'm here.
Awesome. Yeah. I want to tell the world what it's like. And I can imagine it's one of those things that you can't truly appreciate until you get on. It's like riding a bike. You don't really appreciate the brilliance of riding a bike until you actually get on it. Nobody can tell you what it's like until you feel that air flying, you know, through your hair and you feel the exhilaration of the speed. What's it like to be able to learn with Jamie Geller, or it doesn't really matter, what's it like?
It's really incredible. I think each one of us is busy. We all have very busy lives. 2020 has given us an even different meaning to that expression. And, you know, it's funny that we find the time for the things that are important to us. And Jamie is just one of these wonderful, very busy ladies who just, we talk shop more than we can find time for anything else. And we really just decided that this was something that was important to us. And I actually had the crazy idea of asking her, I'm like, Jamie, I know you're very busy, but maybe you want to just do this with me and we'll learn Torah once a weekend. We have to keep it a firm appointment and schedule and stick with it. And she was so excited. She was like, you know what? Yes. And we both were astounded because it's just, there's just, it never feels like there's any time. And then all of a sudden that appointment reminder comes up on my phone and I have like tons of meetings on the calendar for the day. And all of a sudden I see that appointment and I'm like, okay, this is like the high point of my day because we picked our own topic and we're learning about something. I can go on and on about how much I love Shabbos. And we actually found a topic for us and we really, it's helped us really grow and together and individually. And, you know, we just enjoy it so much. And I think that it adds another element and layer and depth to our relationship and to ourselves, where you then apply the things that you're learning. We can always be learning new things every day. And even for humans, you know, it's a lot about education and, you know, just learning new things and sharing it. And it's just a great source for it because it keeps us during a time like this to sort of allow ourselves to grow and, you know, do better and all of that. But I just want to say one thing about Shabbos. It's really my favorite day of the week. I too just love to like, oh, to turn off the emails, to turn off the phone, especially every single person that's on this, I'm sure appreciates, but the social influencers and the amount of, you know, work that we carry online, it's such a blessing. We have this space where we really don't even have to, it's also universally understood. It's not like taking a day off and people just don't know where you are. It's this day where it's there for us. Hashem, you know, created it there for us. He literally said, stop working. You know, this is here for you to rest. And I always say that I burn the candle at both ends because people don't even know if I live in Israel or New York because I'm just always awake and doing work. And but I always think that the middle section of that candle is really Shabbos. I literally live for Shabbos. I somewhat get sad when it starts getting dark out and I really am groaning. I'm like, I just don't want to turn on the phone or the news or plug everything back in. Can I just get another day? And I've also learned to really appreciate 3-day Yamim Tovim so much more. It's become a vacation. But Shabbos is just so special. Learning with someone is so special. And even just this challah bake, I think summarizes it. It's, we could have all done this in our own homes, watching a YouTube video or something. The energy, the specialness is that we're here with other people. And that's the same thing with our learning. I mean, Partners in Torah gives us that opportunity. And it just really is a wonderful program that if anybody can get an ounce of what Jamie and I have taken from this program, I really just urge you, like, try it. I think you're going to find that it's really, really special.
Thank you so, so much for sharing that. I've gotten to know Nikki over the last, I don't know, few months or so, and it's really been really remarkable. And the next one, she's an old friend, Nina. I know her for at least a week, that's for sure. And as I've gotten to know her over the last week, she has really made a deep impression on my life. She runs a Facebook group with over 1 million followers called Accidental Talmudist. She and her husband are film producers and have every word that she has said to me while we were on the phone made me feel like what a special neshama. She just exists to be able to share with the world in her own very dignified, very private way. She is such a sharer. So Nina, can you tell us what it's like? She's also been learning with Partners in Torah for how long has it been, 4 or 5 years? And I think she's here and she's joined with her partner, which has a really remarkable life story in and of herself. Nina, welcome, welcome, welcome. Let's see your face.
Oh, thank you so much, Adina. I'm just so thrilled and honored to be involved in this amazing event. You know, this has been the unprecedented year. There's been so many unprecedented things, and most of them are not good. But here's something unprecedented that's very, very good. Hundreds of Jewish women from all over the world baking challah and learning and coming together. So it's fantastic. Let me, I'll tell you a little bit about myself and my own story. So I was born to Jewish parents. But, you know, like 80% of the Jews in the world, we were thoroughly and completely assimilated. You know, my great-great-grandparents came from Eastern Europe, probably about 1900. And some of them came to the States and some of them went to South America. And, you know, with each succeeding generation, they shed more and more of their Yiddishkeit, of their Jewish identity and their Jewish practice. So by the time it came to my generation, it was pretty much, we were bagels and lox Jews. And by that, I mean, you know, really our only connection to our Jewish identity was, you know, a taste for smoked fish and sour pickles. And that's pretty much what it was. But, you know, I always was so interested and curious. Like I knew I'm part of this ancient tribe, but what does that mean? I wanted so bad to be part of it. And I didn't know where to go, who to ask. I mean, back in the day, back in the 80s, you know, this was before the internet. This was, there wasn't Chabad all over like there is now. And I just didn't have anybody to ask. I didn't know anybody that was an observant Jew. Interestingly, almost everybody I knew was Jewish. Most of my friends were always Jewish. And nobody lit Shabbos candles. Nobody had a mezuzah. Nobody even went to shul, not even on the holidays. And there was this kind of feeling like, well, you know, religion is for people who are stupid and weak. And we, you know, sophisticated, educated people have moved way beyond that. And it wasn't until my 20s when I started going to Jewish singles events that I connected with the Jewish world. And I met my husband, and he came from a more traditional family than mine. His mom is a Holocaust survivor from Hungary. So they had a very strong, you know, Jewish identity, but, you know, not very observant. And after his bar mitzvah, he was kind of out of there. But we met and we both were just so interested in learning and growing spiritually. And that's what we did. And we started, and our path has been very, very, very slow. Okay. There's some people that become religious and it's like from one day to the next, they're there. Not us. We just inching along. We started at a Reform synagogue and then we were there for a while and then a conservative and then conservadox. And finally we started keeping Shabbos. I have to tell you that connecting with Hashem and with Torah and with the Jewish community has transformed my life more than I could ever explain. I think really the best way I could, the best analogy is like in The Wizard of Oz, when Dorothy goes from black and white world to full color. And that's, I think, how it is when you invite Hashem and when you invite Torah into your life. So my husband, Sal, and I were so excited with everything. You know, we were these new Baal Tshuvas and we wanted to share what we learned and share what we were doing. And so we started a social media, a blog and a Facebook page called Accidental Talmudist. And we decided just, you know, share what we love about Judaism and maybe some other, you know, unaffiliated Jews like we used to be would connect with it. So, you know, we're Hollywood people, we're filmmakers, we're storytellers. So we make videos and live shows. We do, my husband teaches a daily Daf Yomi Talmud class. We do articles and holiday stuff. We have like a wide range of programming. And, you know, if we had 100 followers, like we would have been thrilled. But to our astonishment, this grew and grew and grew. And we really realized that we were tapping into something, which is this thirst. You know, we live in such a materialistic, world. And there is a deep, deep thirst out there for God and for ancient wisdom, you know, that's stood the test of time. So many Jews, like, they don't really know, they don't care, but what we have is a treasure. So now we have over 1 million fans in 70 countries who tune in 6 days a week to see what, you know, what our content is for that day. Half of the people are not even Jewish. Okay, they're very, very interested in Jews and in Judaism and Israel. It's been such a blessing. And I have to tell you, you know, the more that you take on Jewish observance and Jewish learning, the more blessings are gonna come in your life. I mean, it's really like just that simple. You know, you connect with God and you connect with your fellow Jews and you start learning. And the blessings are just gonna flow into your house. Thank God, that's what's happened with us. And one of the biggest blessings of my Jewish journey has been Partners in Torah. This organization is so life-changing, so amazing. So I was matched with my amazing, special, beloved partner, Cindy Schwartz, about 6 years ago. I think she's here somewhere. Cindy, I love you if you're here. You know, we learned together. We have a lot in common. She, like me, she didn't grow up religious. You know, she's Baal Tshuva. And we just totally connected on a real soul level and started learning together. You know, it's just a half an hour a week. First, we started with the Siddur, the prayer book. Then we learned a lot about Emunah. Right now, we're studying Pirkei Avos, the ethics of the fathers from like the beginning, from the Mishnah. Cindy is an incredibly remarkable woman for many reasons, not least of which is the fact that she is extremely disabled. Cindy has advanced MS, and the only part of her body that she can really control is just, I think, like a couple fingers. She's completely incapacitated. She depends on other people for everything, for her most basic needs in life. And I have to tell you that this woman is the most upbeat, joyful. Every time I call her, every time I talk to her, hey, Cindy, how's it going? Oh, it's fantastic. I'm great. I'm having such a good day. And I know she's not always having a good day. And I know she doesn't, you know, it's very hard work for any of us to always feel good. And for somebody like her, I mean, Cindy deals with the kind of challenges that most of us, thank God, could never even dream of. And she's so beautiful inside and out, so inspiring. And you know, she says, I think there's some people that if they were stricken with this kind of disease would say, well, how could I believe in God? You know, what kind of a God would give me this challenge? And Cindy totally turns it around. And she says, you know, because she doesn't really have the full use of her body, you know, like others do, she doesn't really have a body fully. So she feels like she is a pure soul. She's just a neshama that she says she's so connected with Hashem, with God, that she actually says it's a blessing, her condition. So if you are learning with a partner in Torah, then you know what I'm talking about. It's an amazing program. It's just such a blessing for both partners. I mean, I hope I'm a blessing to Cindy, but she's definitely a blessing to me. And if you are not signed up with Partners in Torah, what are you waiting for? I mean, it's free. It's just a half an hour a week, which is not a big time commitment at all. You got to trust me on this, whether you're from birth or Baal Tshuva or just kind of dipping your toe into Jewish learning, like whatever your level is, Partners in Torah is for you. You're not going to believe how much the blessings will flow once you sign up for it. So anyway, kol hakavod to Adina and everybody at Partners in Torah and all the influencers and all the amazing women from all over the world that are here. And I bless that we should all grow in learning and grow closer to Hashem and grow closer to each other.
Thank you. הנה יום גאולו, יום שבוסים תשמורו וישמני סגולה. לינו ויחר תבוירו. הנה יום גאולו, יום שבוסים תשמורו וישם לי סגולה. לינו ויחר תבוירו. ויאז תחיו לפני וסמלו צפוני. הילג שבס ושבוס היום לשם. ויאז תחיו לפני ושמלו צפוני. הילג שבס שבוס היום.
Going, we're gonna give away some prizes. I want to introduce our next amazing speaker, Alyssa. And after Alyssa, we're gonna have a very special moment with Charlene and Elizabeth.
and we're going to be able to do the mitzvah of taking challah, and we're going to do it in the schus of in the merit of a particular person who contacted me last night. I'm going to tell you her story right after this. But in the meantime, Alyssa. Hello, Alyssa. Who are you with, Alyssa?
Hey, Dina. I've got my helpers here.
Hi, helpers. Thanks for joining. What are their names?
Of my show. This is Ozzy, and this is Miri. Wave hi, guys.
Hi. So, Alyssa, I asked you if you can give away the prizes for us. Ready?
Yeah, okay. So, everyone, this is how it's going to go. We're going to do like an auction here. That's how fast this is going to be. So, open up your chat box, and as soon as I ask the question, put in your answer in the chat box, and the Partners in Power team is going to be picking the winners, and they will notify you, right, Adina?
Yeah, don't worry. She's going to announce in the chat box, or if you want, she'll announce in the chat box, and I'll see if I can take a look at it and announce the names.
Focus on the chat box, okay? Ready? Right. So some of these are going to be a mix of Jewish questions, and some are going to be a mix of how well do you know the influencers?
Fingers ready. Hold on. My kids are getting their fingers ready. Just telling you, all kids, get your fingers ready too. Go ahead.
Okay. So number one, who was Abraham's wife? Put it in the chat box. And the first answer. Oh, wow. You guys are really speedy typers. Okay. Partners in Tower team, y'all have fun trying to figure out who are the winners there, but just focus on, that. Okay, the answer is Sarah or Sarah.
Guess who won that prize? Sarah Benji. Sarah won the prize because she's the first person who put the word Sarah in the chat box. Just announcing the winner. Woo! Good Sarah. Go ahead, Alyssa. Next one.
Who's Rebecca's husband? Rebecca Rifka was her husband. Ooh, I saw the first answer there.
Who was it?
I mean, I have to scroll up for like 5 minutes now because so many of you know the answer. Oh, it was Bathsheba. Just Bathsheba, Isaac.
Alyssa, you can write down everybody's name so that we can give the prizes afterwards. If anybody wins a prize, email us at Partners in Torah and we'll be able to send the prize to you. Go.
Okay. How many sons did Yaakov or Jacob have? Oh, writing it down. Bless you, Barry. I love you so much. Women supporting women. Okay, great. The answer is 12. Okay.
Let's see who's the first in.
Oh, hello.
Atar 11 is the first person to put it in. Mazel tov, Atar 11, you got a prize.
My hands are fine. Yeah. Oh, it's fine. It's okay. Have a little boo-boo. It's okay. Okay. This is a hard one. How many years ago did the Jews leave Egypt?
Ooh. We got 3,000. 2,000.
The exact number of years. And I would like to give a shout out to Rabbi Shalom Garfinkel from Project 613 in Chicago, who has helped give us some of these amazing questions. He is a genius. He macarved my husband and we love him very much. Anyways, the answer is, I just saw it. The answer is 3,332. So whoever was the first one to get that, I've seen a couple of them, not so many of them. Okay, I'm gonna keep going. This question is for kids only, kids 10 and under. So get your fingers ready if you're a kid 10 or under, okay? And my kids can help answer this question also, okay? How many loaves of challah do we have at each meal on Shabbos? Do you remember? It was a Parsha question last week. How many loaves of challah do we have? Does Tati make a bracha on every Shabbos meal? Tell them. What? Tell them. How many challahs?
None.
Well, it isn't exactly none. How many?
There's none.
Come on, my camera shy children. How many?
None.
Two.
Okay. Nah.
Tell them. No, Siri, I don't need you to tell me. Tell me. Tell them how many. Tell them two. Okay, if you said two, you were correct. Good job, Goldwaters. Two. Way to go.
Two.
Okay, two. Goya. Okay, two. Moving on. Okay. Let's jump in and ask a couple of influencer questions. Okay, how well do you know the lovely women who are helping to run this event with partners in Torah? Okay. Danielle Renov. She is the topic of conversation right now. What is Danielle's husband's name?
How are you? What? She's like a gazillion Ellie's. Everyone's writing it.
Her husband is very popular. Sorry, it is not Yaakov, but it is Ellie. Good job, everyone. Okay. How many kids? Okay, now we're moving on to.
You're taking this off.
You were writing numbers before she wrote how many people
were just writing numbers. Okay, Barry's writing it down. Mommy's friend Barry is writing it down. Okay, now we're moving on to Beattie. How many kids does Beattie have?
None.
She actually has a lot of kids.
None.
Someone just wrote 11. Do you think Beattie got a little, her heart sunk a little bit? It's a bracha, Beattie. You should have 11. You should have 37 kids. You got a bracha for 37 kids, Beattie.
Oh, man. Tina, do you want to tell everyone how many kids Beattie has?
She has 5 kids.
Okay, good job. I'm moving on now. Okay, now we're on to, let's talk about Barry for a second. Barryana, Barry Mitzman, however you know her. Barry the Great. Barry the Rebbitson. Okay. What are Barry's kids' names?
Is this yours?
Shkoyach. I saw it. But you guys are moving too fast. Barry definitely wrote it down. Felit Bunder. I saw you first. No, Shira. No.
Rachel Drekobus.
Oh my gosh. No. Sarah Azulai.
Mommy.
Melan Yiddis, Shkoya, you win.
Mommy!
Okay. Yes! Yes, you can help me answer the questions. Okay, this is real mom life. Sorry, we're like getting into bedtime zone over here. Okay, now we're going to talk about Charlene the Queen. Queen Charlene, the Rebbitson, the Jewish Oprah, my friend, my ray of light. Okay, what is Charlene's favorite restaurant in Miami?
None.
She might have two. Charlene.
Oh, my goodness, that is a loaded question. I have so many.
Oh, Charlene, come on.
Oh, Restito, Fuzu, these are all cash.
Well, Charlene, we'll do one about this. We'll do one meat and one dairy.
Okay, good.
So which are they? And I'm assuming they paid you to say this. Go ahead, just kidding. Oh.
No, so my favorite meat restaurant in all of Miami is Fuego. They were the first restaurant to receive the Jonathan and Charlene Aminoff plaque for favorite restaurant at our favorite table. So if you guys are ever there and you see our plaque, snap a selfie, send it over to me, we chef Nachat. And my favorite dairy restaurant in all of the world is, Rustico.
Rustico.
I never liked fish until I had the sea bass and the branzino at Rustico, the best in the world. So Rustico and Fuego, both answers are correct.
Do you have plaques at both places?
Yes, ma'am, we have plaques at both places. And anywhere that has a plaque is really a favorite restaurant, but they were the first two to get it from meat and dairy, so they really deserve the honor.
Okay, great. Meretz Hashem, before my 30th birthday in April, we're gonna be out of this lockdown and I'm gonna go to Miami for my birthday.
Amen, Alyssa, I will set you up with the Charlene and Jonathan table and you'll get like the VIP treatment.
Yes, yes. Okay, great. Everybody just having for me. Leah Bas Shavalea, thank you very much. Okay, next. Back to Danielle. Where does Danielle live? Okay, great. Some of you are very specific. Good job. And the answer is not the Shook. I'm sorry. She wishes she could live there, but she does not. She goes there often. Okay. Next, I'm going to continue to move on. Okay. What is the name of Danielle's book? Excuse you.
Nothing.
Nothing.
Does PLC count?
Miri, say the name of the book. Can you stop playing with the nose spray, please? What's the name of the say?
Nicole wrote PLC. I think she got it.
Peas, love, and carrots. Say peas, love, and carrots. Yeah. Say it loud, though. One, two, three. Peas, love, and carrots. Woohoo! Mazel tov, Danielle. Okay, anyways, moving on. Elizabeth Sabetsky. She's in the hot seat now. Okay, what are Elizabeth Sabetsky's kids' names?
Mommy, you're not letting us answer these questions.
Okay, I see at least a few people who have gotten all three of them. Mazel tov, Liz Sabetsky just had a baby boy. He is super cute. Super cute. Okay.
Not super cute.
He is super. Be nice. Okay, and where does Liz live? Great. Okay. This is really good. What summer kit? Stop. Liz, are you there to come on for a hot second?
Yes. Hi.
Okay. What summer camp did Liz attend?
No, what did I attend? Not my kids.
No, not your kids. Where did Liz?
Where did I go to camp?
Lots of people think you went to Sternberg, Liz. Not quite. I'll give you a hint. It's in Wisconsin. Oh, as Alyssa. That's right.
Did anyone get it?
No, someone wrote same one as Alyssa.
Oh, that's so funny.
LOL, a good Midwest. Yeah, it's not quite a good Midwest.
I think this is the first question that people have been stumped on.
I think it is too.
It's stumped them. Alyssa, I think you won this one.
I totally won this, but I already have a mom. Mommy, you know what? Okay, should I tell everybody?
Yeah, tell them. Mommy,
can you be quiet? Can you be quiet for a Liz went to Beaver Camp in Wisconsin. She is a Beaver babe. I am also a Beaver babe. I think we overlapped, what, for 2 years, Liz? Or something like that? Not Beaver. Bieber.
You're not even 20. I mean, you're not even 30.
I am. I'm not even 30. B-E-B-E-R camp. We had great summers there, right, Liz?
Oh yeah. I may have gotten kicked out, but it's all good.
That's a story. They still wish her mazel tov, so I think everybody's okay now.
Alyssa?
Yeah.
I think we have time for one more question.
Okay, here's a good one. Here, we'll do three about me and answer all three at the same time. Okay, hold on a second. What are my kids' names and where do I live and where am I originally from? Yes! Yes, somebody got it. Miri Ozzy, I live in Chicago and I am from Louisville, Kentucky. Go Cards. I'm often the first Jew people meet from, well, the first Orthodox Jew people meet from Louisville, Kentucky. If anybody is from Kentucky on this right now, you win double. Anybody? The chat box is real, real quiet right now. Okay, next time we've gotta go more to Kentucky next time. But anyways, that was a little, okay, that's fine.
Prizes. If you want a prize, please make sure to email partnersintorah@partnersintorah.org so that you can claim your prizes for this evening. I wanna say something really important. listen up. If you can hear me loud and clear from wherever you are, why did we choose to do this influencer's challah bake? A clue was written on the flyer. A few other clues came out on your email. But truth be told, one of the greatest messages of challah, and I have a ready-made dough over here, one of the greatest messages of challah is that women hold the key for real influence in this world. We invited all these influencers to come on. We invited them to be able to share their platform, to be able to bring people in. Remember we talked about that gap? Oh, come on a second, sweetie pies, don't do this yet because we have to take the challah. We're gonna do the mitzvah now, thank you. When it comes to fusing the gap between our potential and who we are today, we have to feed ourselves. The more we invest in ourselves, the more we can become a greater version of ourselves. What I find to be so remarkable about all these women who joined us today is that they choose to share their platform on a regular basis to be able to inspire others. Many of us, we look at them as like pretty pictures. We love to be able to look at those pretty pictures, but truth be told, they see themselves, and I give them a blessing now that they should be able to continue to see themselves, not as pretty pictures that people like to look at, but as windows that shed goodness and light into the world. Windows that if you see through them, if you look through them, it will connect you to a higher version of yourself. So we're about to take the challah, we're about to do the bracha. Before I tell you who tonight's evening is dedicated to, and we're gonna put a picture up on the screen in a minute, I wanna tell you that in the same way that we put these ingredients together, in the same way that we molded them, we mixed them, and we shaped them delicately, it's a process that takes intention, that takes some skill, it takes a lot of patience. We are told Hashem used, that God used four ingredients to be able to create the world. He used flour, he used dirt, he used water, he used air, and he used fire. And these four components are what make up the world as we know it today. It is not an accident that we use for a basic recipe of challah, we use those same four ingredients. We take dirt, we take flour, and we take water, and we mold it together. Then we let it rise, which infuses it with air, and then we put it in the oven, which gives it its solidity. It solidifies it, and that's what fire does. That this challah is so much a representation of molding the world, shaping the world, creating our own realities. Many of us see ourselves as like victims of circumstance. What happens to us on a daily basis? Like when the dough falls on the ground, or when your children are climbing onto the screen, or in my particular circumstance that I was running late and I jumped in a few minutes before this whole Zoom thing started, or about a half hour beforehand, because I was stuck in traffic, or because someone else's husband is just not necessarily being the person that I want him to be. Why can't he be more like this or that, usually more like me, or my children, or my coworkers, or my teachers, or my bank account, why can't it look like this? And we feel as if we are a victim of circumstance, and truth be told, we shape our own reality, we shape our own happiness, because our happiness lies within us, and we shape the happiness of the people around us in really remarkable ways, and every single woman is an influencer. One of the things, and this is not something you can quote me on, but I find it can't be an accident, women are connected to three unique mitzvos. That's what we're told. What are those mitzvos? Well, one of them is challah, as we see it here. One of them is lighting candles. One of them is mikvah. What are those three things? Well, the main ingredient of challah, and what you really name the entire type of bread after, is the flour. If this is going to be made of spelt flour, then I call it spelt challah. If it's made of, you know, oat flour, I call it oat challah. So truth be told, this is what makes up this challah, is the flour. That's the main ingredient. So flour, and we said it was representing dirt. When we light candles, we set the world ablaze with fire. When we do mikvah, we use water to be able to bring more light and more love into this world. So we have dirt, fire, We have water, but what's the air? How do we use air? Is there a fourth mitzvah that we're uniquely connected to? We're told that women have 9 measures out of the 10 measures of speech in the world. That doesn't just mean that women like to talk a lot. That's not necessarily true. What does it mean women have 9 out of 10 measures? And I truly believe that the fourth mitzvah that women are connected to at the core, our essence, is the power of prayer, the power of tefillah. We push the air through our lungs, up through our mouth, and we shape and mold that air. And whatever comes out of our mouth is going to build the world around us. It's not just prayer towards God. Prayer is a relationship with God. That's what it is. It's the way we use our words for other people in our lives. It's our husbands, it's our children. The way we shape our words, the way we shape that air is going to bring more goodness into this world. So I'd like to take a few moments now. You can share. Shu, if you can share a picture of a very special woman on the screen. I got a phone call last night. Late last night, I got a text first. And they said, my bubby has been on a ventilator in the hospital. She contracted coronavirus. And she said, my young bubby, she's 69 years old. And she said that the prognosis is challenging for them to be able to face. She asked, I see this beautiful event that you're doing. Would you please daven for my bubby? I would like to dedicate the entire event to my bubby. No joke, within a few minutes, they sent a donation that paid for the entire event. And they asked us to daven for her bubby. So I would like to see a picture of her bubby up on the screen. And right before we take challah, as you can see, it's a very powerful, potent time for prayer. Let me get her name out so that I have it prepared. Each and every one of you can daven for and pray for what it is that you want, because everybody's got something challenging in their life, a bubby situation. And truth is, all of the Jewish people, we have a challenging history. Maybe we have a challenging future, who knows? There's so much that we can push through, up our lungs and out of our mouth to make a reality in the world. It is not an accident, ladies, that God created the world with speech, because it is women who recreate the reality in the world, the goodness in the world with our speech. If we can verbalize it, if we can say it from the depths of our heart, we can say we want a better reality for ourselves, for our families, for our communities, for our neighbors, for the world at large. We could be doing so much better. We can have a different world, a different reality. Speak it through your mouth. Because just like challah dough, as we shape it and we mold it, that is truly how we shape and mold the world around us. So I'm going to do the mitzvah. And right after I do this mitzvah, Elizabeth and Charlene are going to join me, and we're going to say a very special prayer in English and in Hebrew for everybody so that you're comfortable, and it'll be shared on the screen. It's a special prayer that you say after you separate challah. Hold on 1 second. Hold on, maybe the picture isn't there. Hold on. This whole entire evening, all of the delicious challahs that will be popping out of ovens, all of the prayers that we say, the tefillos that exit our lips, should be a merit. Your mother, Pearl Phillips, should have a complete recovery from head to toe. Miraculous recovery. Soon, not in 5 months, now. A miraculous recovery. And all the women in the room, if you can think of her in your heart, it will make the night complete. Her name is Ruchama Perel Malka Leah Bas Chana Serel. Thank you so much for making this evening happen. Thank you for approaching me. Thank you for texting me. Thank you for being so, it's the best type of impulsivity when you say, I want to be a part of this mitzvah, because I truly can make a difference. Thank you for putting in the chat box. You can see it before. Many of you know some sick people, some people who are struggling, whether it's Corona. You can insert that name as well as we are going to take them do the mitzvah of challah. Just one second. As we take the mitzvah of challah. Something interesting to take note is that the Jewish people are obsessed with bread. If you think about it, there's hundreds of thousands of women who are making challah this week. And we eat challah on Shabbat. We eat challah on every single holiday. We eat challah at our life cycle events, when people get married, when they have brit milah, when they do circumcisions, at a bar mitzvah, at a bat mitzvah. We're obsessed with challah. Why are we so obsessed with challah? If you think about it, what if I said that there was a tradition that Jews should eat lemon meringue pie at every single event that we do? You would say, that's odd. Why are they so obsessed with lemon meringue pie? But because we're so familiar as Jews, we never ask the question, why are we so obsessed with bread? So I said that bread represents our reality in the world. It represents the fact that we have the ability to create our world. And women have a unique relationship with bread. But interestingly enough, when we see bread in the Torah, we see a very strange type of bread. One of the first times it ever comes on the scene is when there's bread that falls from the sky, the lechem min hashamayim, which is what we call the man. And every single time we have two challahs on our table, it reminds us where all of our reality really comes from the sky. It reminds us that no matter what happens, and that's truly why it's connected to Shabbat. Because Shabbat is the one day where we pull back from creating and we become a created. We become a creature, someone who can't build and can't become, can't work and can't continue. We just be. And it takes greater strength. I can imagine my grandparents. It took tremendous strength to not work on Shabbat when you didn't necessarily know where the food was going to come from your family. What a testimony to trust. What a testimony to true and utter bitachot or emunah in Hashem, that you know exactly where your sustenance comes from. That's why we're obsessed with it. We keep putting in our tables. That lechem is something we keep reminding us of ourselves all the time, where it truly comes from. But when we take a piece away, it reminds us that it's also about giving to the other. And it connects us to a time many, many years ago when the temple was around. There are very few opportunities to remind us of our history. And women do it on a regular basis. We keep a mitzvah that really, in its truest form, looks much more like what it was done in the time of the temple. You would send it to the Kohen Gadol, you would send it to the Kohanim, to the priest. And today we take the challah, we put it away, and we have to destroy it. But we remind ourselves that it would be nice, and we are holding on to hope for our future. Do you know what hope is? Well, remembrance is where you have a string and you connect it to the past. And you hold on to it for dear life, kind of like a balloon, and you never want to let go. You remember the things, and therefore it connects you with your past. But you know what hope is? Hope is where you have a string, and it connects you to the future. And you say, no matter what happens, I know we can get through. Just like Beattie said before, that women always had that hope. And women keep these mitzvahs that were connected to the temple, like mikveh as well, because we realize that we have tremendous hope. We know what history looked like, and we can see a brighter future. And it's remarkable to think that women have this chain where we are holding on to the string that connects us to our past. We're holding on to the string that connects us to our future. And here we are in 2020, keeping those mitzvos, which means we are bonding that chain and we will never let go. Elizabeth, I would love for you and Charlene as well to join me. Charlene will go first. She'll read the Hebrew. I'm going to say the bracha. You want to say it with me, ladies? I have this prepared from before. I'm going to say the bracha. Is the bracha there, or is it just the Yehi Ratzon? If the bracha is not there, then we could put it in the chat box down below so that you can read it out loud. After we say the bracha, the blessing, we're going to read this Yehi Ratzon in Hebrew very quickly. We're going to read the Yehi Ratzon in English. Elizabeth's going to do that. And then after that, we're going to have silence for just a minute. And during that silence, close your eyes, but keep your heart open and use the power of words, the power of air, to bring that reality into the world. Because this is how we can create. And let your soul come alive. Ready? Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech olam. Asher kidishanu b'mitzvosa v'tzivanu lahafresh chala min ha'isa. This is the challah that you take. Harei zu challah. It's about the size of a small golf ball. And when you're finished taking this, remember, this is a time, we keep doing this. It's pretty remarkable that it's since the beginning, the thousands of years we've been doing this. And one day we'll be able to send it to Yerushalayim, where we don't have to send it in the mail overnight anymore. We'll send it to Yerushalayim. But for right now, you wrap it and you burn it just so to make sure that nobody eats from it, because it doesn't belong to us. Part of, by the way, it's a Jewish tradition, almost everything that we own, our time and our money, we always give a little part of it away because nothing really belongs to us. So if you can come on the screen, Charlene, and read the Yeretzon out loud for everybody.
Yeah, Dina, I'm gonna make my own bracha as well because I'm actually live on my Instagram page. So this way we get amens, more amens in the world, okay? Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher kidishanu b'mitzvot v'tzivanu lahafrish challah truma. Harei zu challah. Yehi ratzon lefanecha Adonai Eloheinu v'lehei avateinu shetibneh beit hamikdash b'mehirah b'ineinu v'ten chalkeinu b'drakav. Lasoch u kiratzonach ulevdach b'levav shalem. Yehi ratzon lefanecha Adonai Eloheinu v'lehei avateinu shehamitzvah shel hafrashat challah תחשב כאילו קיימתיה בכופר עציה בדקדוקיה, ותחשב הרמת החלה שאני מרימה, כמו הקורבן שהוקרב על המזבח, שנתקבל ברצון, וכמו שלפנים הייתה החלה נתונה לכהן, והייתה זו לכפרת עוונות, כך תהיה לכפרה לעוונותיי, ואז אהיה כאילו נולדתי מחדש, נקייה מחטא ועוון. ואוכל לקיים מצוות שבת קודש והימים הטובים, עם בעלי וילדינו, להיות ניזונים מקדושת הימים האלה, ומהשפעת של מצוות קלה, יהיו ילדינו ניזונים תמיד מידיו של הקדוש ברוך הוא, ברוב רחמיו וחסדיו, וברוב אהבה, ושתתקבל מצוות קלה כאילו נתתי מעשר, וכשם שהנני מקיימת מצוות קלה בכל לב, כך יתעוררו רחמיו של הקדוש ברוך הוא, לשמרני מצער וממחובים כל הימים, אמן.
Amen. Can you hear it? So, Elizabeth, you want to read it in English?
Hello. Yes. Hi, guys. Am I unmuted? I just want to say that I believe that this is a time to pray for miracles. I've seen in my own life how many beautiful miracles have happened from this moment of prayer. And I really believe it is an open channel to God's ear. So whether it's a child that you're praying for, or a spouse, or the health of a loved one, whatever it is, you know, this is the moment. And so thank you for allowing me to lead you in this prayer in English. May it be your will, eternal, our God, that the commandment of separating the challah be considered as if it had been performed with the sacrifice. Performed it with all its details and ramifications. May my elevation of the challah be comparable to the sacrifice that was offered on the altar, which was acceptable and pleasing. Just as the giving of the challah to the Kohanim in the former time served to atone for our sins, so may it atone for mine and make me like a person reborn without sins. May it enable me to observe the Holy Sabbath or the festival of, with my husband and our children, and to become imbued with its holiness. May the spiritual influence of the mitzvah of challah enable our children to be constantly sustained by the hands of the Holy One. Blessed be he, with his abundant mercy, loving kindness, and love. Consider the mitzvah of challah as if I have given the tithe. And just as I am fulfilling the mitzvah with all of my heart, so may your compassion be aroused to keep me from sorrow and pain always. Amen.
Amen. That's so beautiful. Elizabeth, tell us a little bit about the power of prayer in your life. I heard a really beautiful story about little Ali that you're holding now, and it blew me away.
The power of prayer is something that I would never have really been able to grasp if I had not experienced it myself. It's one of those things that we hear about and we talk about, but until it happens to you in your own life, it's hard to really believe, you know, with your whole heart and the way that I do. And, you know, we all go through hard times. I've heard a lot of women talking about that tonight. And, you know, the idea of hanging on to Emunah and prayer through those hard times, it can be very challenging. And there are moments of anger, moments of extreme sadness, confusion, and questioning. And so, you know, will I ever come out of this? And I, after a very long journey of infertility and three pregnancy losses, two ectopic pregnancies, one of which I had to have an emergency surgery for, and then a miscarriage, I became pregnant this past February and was rushed to the hospital with a crazy reaction to the progesterone that I was taking from the IVF cycle I had done, was told that I had lost the pregnancy. And I got out of the hospital. I was there for 3 days. And when I, between the time that I got released from the hospital and the time that I went back to my doctor, I had this amazing friend in my life. Her name is Annette, and she organized several challah bakes. I think there were hundreds of women from all over baking challah and praying for me. And when I had my doctor's appointment, we were all just completely shocked, including the doctor and the staff there, that this pregnancy was viable and there was a heartbeat and this is my baby. And I look at him and I really owe it. I believe that he is the manifestation of the prayers of so many women who cared enough to pray for me while they were taking their dough and baking challah. And I just think if there's anything in your life, whether it's, you know, looking for a spouse or, you know, I know a lot of people are out of work right now. This is a really hard time in our lives. And it's an important moment to ask God for whatever you want. And, you know, I think we should all just focus on what we, you know, what we want to ask God for and really pour our tears, pour our hearts into this moment. And, you know, all of our prayers should be answered. So thank you for having me. And thank you for Ollie.
Very, very much. I find that it's so remarkable that the Torah is Hashem's word to us and prayer is our word to Hashem. In any relationship, you need a conversation. It can't be a one-sided street. Sometimes what we do is that when we have prayer in our minds, it sounds more like a shopping list. Give me this, give me this, give me this, give me this. And so often they were like looking at me, me, me. This is what I need. I'm in pain. This is what I want. And sometimes it could be something more trivial, like when we want to lose weight or something. And sometimes it's bigger. You want to find love. You're single and you're desperate to, or your bank account looks too empty, or you're struggling with health issues, or you need clarity in terms of life's decisions. And so you make that big list. But you know what happens when you keep pouring it in and you invest, when you carve time out of that schedule? Then you start to get that clarity. You understand the world around you so much more. So I have to make a bold statement. Right before we're gonna bring Barry on, and she has the most beautiful, beautiful video that she recorded for us, and it's gonna be debuted tonight for the first time. Nobody's seen this. This is really remarkable. So I just started working for Partners in Torah, and I've been so busy since they brought me on, I realized I feel like I'm a living lie. I don't have a partner in Torah. Now, do I teach on a regular basis? Yes. But everybody else on staff has a partner in Torah, and I haven't gotten around to it. So this Shabbat learning program, and I always say that if you want a more romantic relationship with your significant other, you have to learn about love and marriage. It fills you up and creates a romantic relationship with any subject. You want to create a romantic relationship with Shabbat. If you want to feel inspired when you light those candles, you want to feel like, ah, oh, it's a rejuvenated feeling. Like it's the first time you met Shabbat, so then you learn about Shabbat. So I'm going to boldly put it out there. I want a partner. Tonight, I'm going to sign up. And I want you guys to sign up with me tonight. right now in the chat box, if you plan on signing up for our Shabbat learning program, 30 minutes a week, so we can create a romantic relationship with one of the most important mitzvahs together. Rachel Jacobus?
Adina, can I come on and be your partner?
Yes!
Amazing!
I are going to be partners together and we're going to learn together. Thank you. Oh, I'm so honored.
Thank you.
You and I are going to learn together. In fact, this week, I'm going to be doing a live podcast on our first subject, which is candle lighting. And maybe you and I will be able to learn something together. And whatever we learn together, I'm going to share on that podcast. If you want to come on, you can come on. You
know, let's do it.
We want to create a romantic relationship with our candles. Whatever mitzvah that we learn about a Shabbos, we want to feel like it comes alive. We want it to be that it fills us up. And that is what. So, look at this. We have so many people on this is amazing how many people are signing up. So I know how it works when it comes to inspiration. After Barry, by the way, we're going to do some braiding with Danielle, and then we're going to end our evening. But I know how it works with inspiration. Inspiration is like lightning. It shoots across the sky, lights up your whole entire life, and you say, I want to be a better person. And then you know what happens? As soon as the lightning goes out, you're no longer inspired. And all of a sudden, it's busy, and you're done. So before we get off the Zoom, before the lights of the Zoom on our computers fade away, Elizabeth and I are signing up beforehand. In fact, when I play the music video, I'm going on to Partners in Torah.
We're going to sign up.
Before he goes, if you want to be able to feel inspired in anything, and truth, you know, it's not even about Shabbat, because it will lead to more learning experiences. You want to invest in your marriages? Feel accountable to your learning partner. Learn every single week about that subject. You want to know more about parenting? You learn it about parenting. You want to feel more inspired in general about your mood with depression or anxiety? Torah has a subject for every single part of your life. You fill up your cup, you can spill onto others. And if each and every one of us keep filling up, we can influence the world in remarkable ways. Elizabeth, I'm so excited that you are
I'm so excited. Guys, we have to sign up before the inspiration fades, like Adina said.
Exactly, and I'm gonna introduce Barry. Barry, you're coming on, you ready? Barry is really special. She has she's an amazing Instagram celeb that I think it's Barryana on Instagram. And many of you might not know this about her, but she has a beautiful voice. And she did this literally until 2 a.m. just for this event. This is the first time you'll ever see her sing this song. And this song is really about hope. It's about what I talked about before, connecting to history and really feeling like there is hope for a better future no matter what it is that you're going through. Barryana, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me. Hey guys, look at you. You're on the big screen?
Yeah.
This is my daughter Yiddis, and this is my son Mel, for those who wanted to know the answer to the trivia question, who didn't know the answer. Yiddis is 3 years old, and Eli Melech, also known as Mel, is 1.5. Everybody say hi.
Hi.
So we are so excited to be a part of this. Oh, you're waving hi, good guy. And we had this one plan for this challah bake, and, you know, woman plans and Hashem plans better. And in short, I've created a video specifically for this event. It's a song I have never sang before. It is called Wings by Farhi. And the purpose of the song is talking about bringing an end to our struggles, bringing an end to our very difficult challenges and coming back home on the wings of an eagle. And I spoke to Adina earlier in the week, and I learned the story of, you know, the difference between an eagle and a regular bird in carrying their young is that an eagle carries its children on its back as opposed to holding it between its claws on the bottom. But one thing that I never thought of was what Adina shared with me, which is the concept that the difference is not only between the way the mother carries its young, the difference is in between the way the children have cope with that. You know, the way the children If children are picked up by a regular bird, they're just lifted. Easy, no problem. But if you are the child, or if you need to get on to an eagle, you have to get on. You need to jump. You need to take a step. And I only began rekindling my passion for singing just a few months ago when I went on a trip to Eretz Yisrael before the world changed forever. And I met with the beautiful Dalia Oziel, who's on here, and she showed me that there was a need. I grew up singing in different audiences, male audiences, female audience, mixed audiences. And when I chose to sing only in the presence of women, I figured that my passion for singing was over because it's a chalabek. So what I realized was there are so many women, every Jewish woman, exactly what I've been saying this whole time, every Jewish woman is an influencer. We influence each other. I saw, you know what? There is a need for my talent and I can share that with people. I can actually use my passion for something and not have it go in vain. All of the people who've been featured on here, they make the choice to, you know, let's say run an outreach organization or use social media for the purpose of inspiring people to keep tzniut or encouraging people to have Jewish pride or enabling other Jewish women to create businesses for themselves. Bring a Kiddush Hashem into the world and onto the social space. So each and every one of us, we take steps, we choose to learn with someone, we decide to keep Shabbos, we take something upon ourselves because we are the little birds, the baby eagles that are making that jump. And I hope that you enjoy this video. This video also has subtitles so you can sing along with it. And it's just amazing to be here with all of you. Thank you so much. You just wave.
Hi.
Thank you, Barry. Take it away.
Thousands of years we've been waiting, through all the pain and hearts breaking. Oh, and I'm tired. Oh, and I'm tired. Moments of pain and frustration, but I'm told to have faith and have patience. Oh, and I'm trying, I promise I'm trying. On the wings of an eagle, fly right on home. Led by Avraham Avinu, oceans are on. With my children beside me, their hands and mine. All these years and tears of suffering will fade away as we sing our cry. Oh, and it goes like da 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 da. Pain and hearts breaking. Oh, and I'm tired. Oh, and I'm tired. Moments of pain and frustration, but I'm told to have faith and have patience. That it's our time. Please be our time. On the wings of an eagle, fly right on home. Led by Avraham Avinu, oceans with my children beside me. Their hands in mine. All these years of tears and suffering will fade away as we sing our cry. Oh, when it goes like la di da da di da da, la di da da di da da, la di da da di da da, la di da da.
Listening to this song, I'm a grandchild of four Holocaust survivors, and I can imagine that when my bubby was hiding in the woods, and my grandfather was in Auschwitz, and my other grandfather was fighting on the Russian front line, and my other Safta was pretending to be someone who wasn't Jewish within a non-Jewish family hiding, when they were all in a pretty dark place, in their wildest dreams, they would never believe that a few decades later, they would have a granddaughter that's living in Miami Beach in a nice home, sitting on a Zoom with hundreds of people from all over the country baking challah together. In our darkest of moments, no matter what happens in the future, that's what hope is all about. That's what prayer is all about, is connecting to whatever it is in your wildest dreams you can never, ever imagine. Continue to dream. Thank you so much, Barry, for that. That was so beautiful. I hope it goes up on YouTube so that we can watch it over and over and over and over again. And I feel like I want to watch this and listen to it while I bake my challah next week and the week afterwards and the week afterwards. Thank you so much. I'm going to open it up to Danielle, who's going to braid with us for just a few minutes, a 2-minute braiding. And then I want to close it with a few words, and then we're going to end the evening. Danielle, you're on. You still up, Danielle? She there?
Hi.
She's awake. Look at her commitment to us. Oh my God. What time is it there?
I don't know, because my watch is at what time? I don't know. My watch is on my devices. We're good. We're here. We're ready to bake. We have to cook our challah. We're not going to sleep anytime soon, but we're all good. Baruch Hashem.
21.
First of all, I just want to say that. What?
A few people on that are up with you just to see you, by the way. They're in the chat box.
Oh, you guys are amazing. Thank you. First of all, I just want to say that this whole evening has been incredible. Every single person that spoke, I want to start naming everybody, but it's like so late at night that I don't want to forget anybody, but literally every person that spoke, I took something that I just went right to my heart, and I feel inspired by and influenced by, and it was just a remarkable evening. So thank you so much for having me, because I don't know if I would have been up otherwise and been able to absorb all of this. And, you know, Hashem, I always learned that Hashem lets you hear exactly what you need to hear. And there were so many things I needed to hear tonight. So really thank you to every person that got on and that spoke. And I was reading the comments, and so many of the comments were inspiring. And I think that's the point of calling it an influencer's challah bake, is that literally every person is an influencer. And I've said this before on my Instagram. It's a word that I'm not even comfortable
with using it because it doesn't differentiate anybody. My job is not an influencer because we're all influencers. It's like saying like, you're a human. It's like writing the word human underneath your profile picture. We're all just human. We're all influencers because the second you come into contact with somebody, your behavior is influencing them and their behavior is influencing yours. And what I love about actually that word is that we can use it to protect ourselves and we can use it to give over love to other people. And I try to surround myself with the best possible people, positive people, people that are uplifting and encouraging and growthful people. And that in turn influences me to be the kind of person that I can be so that I can give that back. And I really love that. And now we're going to go to braiding challah, which is my absolute favorite thing to do because until now we were just adding ingredients to our challah. And then we let our challah rise and now it's time to braid it. And once you braid the challah, you take this dough and you mold it into something beautiful. But then you go and you put it into the oven and then it's all up to Hashem. It's out of your hand. You don't know what's going to come out of that oven. Sometimes it rises, sometimes it doesn't, sometimes the braid breaks apart, sometimes it doesn't, sometimes it's less beautiful, more beautiful, fluffy inside, sometimes it's a little bit doughy, these things just happen. It's all about Hashem, and until now, we're talking about emuna, 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 and emuna is so important, faith, belief in God, a fundamental belief. I believe God exists in this world. I believe God put me in this world is so important, but then there's the next step, and that next step is bitachon. Bitachon is the practical application of our faith. What does it mean to have faith? What does it mean? It means that we see God in every single thing we do. It means that when we put the ingredients into this bowl today, we believe that God is willing these ingredients to work together to form a dough. When we mold our dough, we ourselves are doing the action of braiding it, but it's not only up to us. It's not in our hands. We did the job we needed to do, and now we're giving it over to Hashem, and we're saying, Hashem, I know you are here today, and you are going to take care of the rest of this dough, however it's meant to be. And He is running every single second of our lives. We are breathing in and out because of Him. We are making challah because of Him. We're, our organs are working. Everything is happening because He is willing it to happen each and every second. And I love that. And when I put the challah in the oven, it's always something I think about. That's it. It's in your hands. There's nothing more I can do. And now we're going to go on and we're going to start braiding. I thought a lot about what kind of braiding to do. I always think about this at challah bakes. Should we do like four different fancy braiding techniques? And honestly, I go back and forth in my mind all the time, but I always come back to the same thing. Like, why four techniques? Nobody can remember them. Let's just do one really good technique, get it done, really remember it, walk away with something practical and something beautiful that we can use and make the job happen. So that's what we're doing. We're doing my favorite one. It's a six braid challah because we always use it. Now, sometimes, you know, there's a lot of different customs regarding how we braid our challah and why we braid our challah. On Friday nights, we sing a lot of songs at the Shabbos table or hymns or zmiros. And most of them are written by a lot of very old Kabbalists. And one of them is written by the Arizal, Rav Yitzchak Luria. And he mentioned in his hymn that we are commemorating or we want to remember the 12 loaves of bread that were placed on the Shulchan, on the holy table, in the temple, in the Beis HaMikdash, in the temple. And what we want to do is we want to evoke the memory of that holiness and bring it to our Shabbos table. So we have two loaves to symbolize the double portion of manna that we received from Hashem when we were in the desert. But we want to evoke the memory of those 12 loaves. So what do? Some people, this is so crazy, I never knew this until I learned it a few years ago. Some people make break apart challahs. Like they take six round balls and they make two of those. And then they have 12 bowls of challah when they put them together on their Shabbos table. But a lot of us braid our challahs. So why do we braid it? Because when we braid a challah, we make this long, elongated oval type of thing. And we make two of them. And those loaves resemble the Jewish letter Vav, which is the sixth letter in the alphabet, which gives the letter Vav the numerical value of six. When you take Vav and Vav, six plus six, that equals 12. And I absolutely love that. Now we make a six-stranded challah because six strands and six strands equal 12 strands. And I absolutely love that. And it happens to be very easy to do. You only have to remember this one mantra. Okay, hold on. Let me move this where you could see it over here. Okay. I think you could see that now. first, second in the second over, first in the middle. That's all she knows. That's all you have to remember. Second over, first in the middle. Watch this. So I have my six strands. I just pinch them together. You don't have to do anything fancy at the top. Hold on. I'm going to move you down here so you could see from, I don't know which camera you're looking at. Oh, that was magical. I don't know how that happened. Okay. Second over, first in the middle, just like that. Second over, first in the middle. Second over, first in the middle. Second over, first in the middle, and you're just gonna keep alternating sides. It's very easy. Second over, first in the middle. Now go to this side. Second over, first in the middle. You're gonna keep having a new first because your second is gonna become your next first, but don't even think about it like that. Just one side, second over, first in the middle, and now I have to go to this side. Second over, first in the middle. Second over, first in the middle. Second over, first in the middle. Take the end. Now this is really what makes a challah beautiful. It's the extra step that they never tell you about. You're gonna take your dough, turn it sideways. I just like to pinch the ends, tuck them under, make it really nice and tight at the ends, and then you're gonna take your dough. This is the craziest thing, and it is the easiest thing you can do. You could do it with any braid, shape, any amount of strands. Take your dough, smush just a little bit. One roll this way, one roll this way, and boom, done. Stick it on your sheet pan. Okay, I have six more rolled out. I'm gonna take my same saran wrap that I covered my dough with. I'm gonna cover this dough with it, and this is gonna rise for 40 minutes. Meanwhile, I'm gonna move on to my next ones. I have all mine done. I just saved two for you so that we can do it again really quickly. See, I have my six strands here. Second over, first in the middle. See, second over, we go to the other side. Now I have four and four, just gonna first in the middle. Can you go get her, please? Second over, first in the middle. Second over, first in the middle. Second over, first in the middle. And it literally moves that fast. That's all you have to remember. Second over, first in the middle. That is your mantra. That is your mantra forever when you make challah. Don't forget it. Second over, first in the middle. It's really easy. Even Leah Bela does it, right? Yeah. We're gonna show them the challahs that you made while we were listening to Barry's gorgeous, beautiful song. Look at that. Pinch the edges, smushed it together, gave it a little roly-poly, and boom. Can you see that? Oh, okay, we're on this screen. Look at that. So easy, so nice. It's that little roll that makes all the difference. Now I'm gonna go back to my original sheet I made, which is here. I made this one and Leia Bela made this one and she's 9 years old. I mean, she happens to be super duper awesome, but really it's easy, right? Yes. Is it difficult?
No.
Anybody can do it. And now you're gonna take your plastic off, let it rise for 35 to 40 minutes. This rise is very important. It's what gives your challah that last bit of fluffiness that it needs. But you don't want to let it rise for more than 40 minutes because that's when your dough will go too far and sort of become yeasty tasting and not pleasant. So it's really that sweet spot between 35 to 45 minutes, not more, not longer. Now my secret to a really, really golden challah is one egg and two egg yolks, because the egg yolks have this like wonderful, delicious golden quality to it that really just give you that crust that you need. I'm gonna take it very quickly. Egg your challah, not too much egg. My mother always used to say, like, we don't want scrambled eggs on our challah. It's true. That's what will happen if you put it in the oven with a pool of egg. So just very lightly. Hi, Elisheva. Hi. We're gonna braid our challah. We're gonna egg our challahs. Oh my gosh, you could see right away. It's just from the extra egg yolks. It's so golden and really gives it that brown, gorgeous, luxurious challah feel you want. And then my most simple topping, you could do any topping you want. You could do crumbs. You could buy everything with bagel spice. You could put sesame seeds. You could just put salt. But my favorite, most simple method is just a tiny little sprinkle of sugar right on top for that last bit of sweetness. And also just a really good shine when it comes out of the oven. And that's it. This is ready to go in a 180 degrees Celsius, 350 degree Fahrenheit oven for 30 minutes, give or take, depending on your oven. And that's it. That's how we make challah, my friends. I'm honored to be here. It was beautiful, beautiful to spend the night with you guys. And thank you so much for having me and bringing me into your homes and making challah with me. This was just amazing. I feel uplifted and I hope you do too. And I just want to wish you all a beautiful, restful, peaceful, relaxing, and rejuvenating Shabbos.
so much. That is great. Actually, this is my first sixth grade that I ever did. I did it right here with my daughter. So I first saw you explained it very carefully. I get really, oh, here it is. See, my first one. It's a little bit different than yours. I see I skipped a few things, but I figured this is about trying something new and stepping out of our comfort zone tonight and be able to own our own influence. So thank you so much, Danielle, for explaining to us. So I'm going to tell you a quick story and then we're going to end off. There was once a girl in high school living in America who felt very alone and lost in many ways. You know, it's very hard to be a female, a teenage girl. There's body image issues and you not knowing what you want to be when you grow up and craving all of these wonderful things, and you feel frustrated as a teenager. And in many ways, she was like a little bit lost, I would say. In her school, they hired a speaker to come during one of the assemblies. Usually they had, the speakers kind of looked the same. But when they came to this particular speaker, it looked very different. She had blonde hair and big blue eyes. She went into the front of the room, and this young teenage girl usually liked to go to the bathroom and kind of like snooze a little bit during speakers. But she thought she looked very different. Something about her that made an impression on her. So she decided she was gonna stand in the back of the room and just give it a few minutes. So she listened to this woman. And from the moment that this woman opened up her mouth, she was glued to her completely. She listened to every single word. The woman spoke with such poise and with such dignity, with such self-respect, with such wisdom, with such strength, and she was very much inspired. Something inside her said, you know what? If I could one day be like that, then maybe I'm in it for the Jewish thing. The woman who stood in front of that room was a woman, none other than Rebbetzin Esther Youngreis, who passed away just a few years ago. And the girl in the back of the room was me. Didn't really feel very inspired in my Judaism, but something about her influenced me. I never had a personal relationship with her, but I heard her speak a few other times, and one day I came up to her and I said, you know, I remember when you spoke to me in high school and you made such a difference. Yes, I went back to doing all these crazy things that teenagers do, but that fleeting moment that you stood in front of the room, that you chose to take time out of your schedule to come to high school, that moment influenced me. And in the back of the room, I said, maybe I can grow up to be someone like her. And I know I'll never be able to grow up to be someone like her, that I know. But all I can say is I have a vision for myself. She made an impression on me to be able to share whatever it is that I have with other people. I want to leave you with the bracha. All the influencers that tuned in tonight, you should be able to be that window that I described before, a window that could truly shed more light into the world. We don't need more pretty pictures. We need windows to use your platform for the good. Use your platform to make women, their husbands, men, to make the world a better place. I give you a bracha, all the women that tuned in tonight. They should be able to shine your light unto the world. And you should be able to touch other people in the same way that Rebbetzin Heller touched me, because look what someone can become if they just are touched by one person. By one person. I want to thank you so much for joining. And in the spirit of challah, may we mold and shape the world to be a better place for all of us. Thank you so much for joining Partners in Torah tonight. Thank you, all of you remarkable women.
Think you're never wrong. You carry them day and night within love. careless love. You give up your dreams when push comes to shove. And so many times you forget. Think my job isn't so great. Yeah, so many times you regret. With a woman inside you debate. So many times.